Also those, is it working?
Yeah, it's on.
Okay. All those that are joining us via Zoom and on the internet. Does anybody have any praise reports or prayer requests?
I would just like to thank everyone who came out yesterday for the Mochitsuki, the rice pounding event. It's been 3 years since we've had this event, and I think it was really a great success, thanks to so many who came out and helped. And I know it was a lot of work, but I think it was really nice. We had neighbors from the surrounding area who picked up flyers that were passed out, who came, and so I think that was really positive. So I just hope that we can all pray that some of these seed may have been planted in the hearts of some of these neighbors and new visitors, and maybe they'd come to join us at another event or one of our worship services. So thank you to everybody who helped with the Mochitsuki yesterday.
I'd like to add that I heard there was approximately about 130 people that came yesterday. So, and Denise had said that there were a lot of new faces. So it seemed like it was very successful. And I was going to sit there and say, well, let's give a round of applause to all those that helped. But looking around the congregation, I think pretty much all of you were participants yesterday. So thank you very much. Okay, a couple other things. Just to keep you updated on the Building Fund campaign, we have collected over $8,900. So we're a little bit better than halfway through our campaign for the matching funds. Another thing is the year-end giving for your taxes are back in the foyer. They're in a box there. Pick them up on your way out. And I believe we're going to be, those that do not come regularly will be mailing them. Okay. Today we're going to be praying for the Ramadi Mukti mission in India. And this group was formed, this mission was formed over 130 years ago by a Christian woman there, Indian, and they now have several hostels throughout the country, and they also have a main campus of about 130 acres, and on that campus they have seven schools, one being for blind and another for those in need. There's also a hospital and housing facilities, so keep them in prayer. I think, as we all know, India is a country that is in great need of caring for their people. I think that's about it, and nobody has anything else. If you would like to join me in congregational prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we gather here together and we give thanks to you. Lord, you have provided for us in so many different ways, and you stand by us in so many different ways. Just like yesterday, we had so many volunteers that made the event such a success, and may it be a blessing to those people that have come, that maybe there'd be outreach, and that because of what our volunteers did, that they would touch their hearts and maybe bring them to you, Lord, either here or somewhere else. But at any rate, we hope that it's successful in bringing people to you. Father, I give thanks to you for this church, how you support us, how you stand by us, and are here at all times. Father, we can never forget that you're with us 24 hours, every day of the year, and at all times. Father, you always are a blessing to us. Father, I just lift up to you those that are in need of your healing touch or your emotional support. Those for mom, Alyssa Carr Mahone, Aaron Gray, John Slagle, Linda's niece, Andrea, Sagumi's husband, Rick, for healing, for her friends Mike, Rick, and Tammy, Lloyd Henning for strength, and same for Barbara Fukuzawa, Maurice Gordon's sister, Nora, Hato Sagino, Marge Smith, and comfort for the Fukumura, Carr, Paris, and Chin families, and the Nakamura families. Father, we just lift these all up to you, and those that you know of that also need you to be with them. We also ask for peace in Ukraine and Afghanistan, and for continued rain here in Santa Barbara. Father, this morning we lift up to you the Ramabai Mukti Mission in India, how they do outreach and support of women and children in need. Father, we just give thanks to you for what you do for them and how you stand by them and how they have succeeded all these years. Over 130 years, they've been doing this outreach and have been so successful. And so we just lift them up to you for praise and for your being with them. Father, we just pray for all of our missions that we help to fund. Father, we just lift all of them up to you, and may they continue to do your work globally and bring people to you. For in all these things we pray, in your name, amen. At this time, if you, while the praise group comes up, if you'd like to greet each other,
well, good morning, Bethany Church, and our praise team today is Tammy and Derek, and I are two of our regulars, Utica and Linda, are a little under the weather, so please keep them in prayer too for healing this week. And if you would stand and join us, we'd like you to sing with all your might and with the Spirit. And join us in singing Our God.
Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you.
Into the darkness,
into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you.
Our God is greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Into the darkness,
into the darkness you shine. Of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Thank you.
And if our God is for us,
and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against?
Our God is greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
our God. All right, hungry. Hungry, we come to the Lord because he's the one that can satisfy.
Hungry, I come to you, for I know you satisfy.
Falling on my knees.
I'm falling on my knees, offering all of me. Jesus, you're all this heart is living for. So I wait for you. So I wait.
I come to you.
Hungry, I come to you, for I know you satisfy. I am empty. deep, but I know your love does not run dry.
His love never runs dry. And now, Jesus, the Lion and the Lamb.
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born of our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a king that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion. He bled as the lamb. He carries my healing in his hands. Jesus. There is a name I call in times of trouble. There is a song that comforts in the night. There is a voice calms the storm that rages. He is Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion. He bled as the lamb. He carries my healing. Messiah, my Savior, there is power in your name. You're my rock and my Redeemer, there is power in your name. You walk on the waters, you speak to the seas, you stand in the fire beside me. You roar like a lion, you bled as the lamb, you carry my healing in your hand. God, you walk on the waters, you speak to the sea. You stand in the fire beside me. You roar like a lion. You bled as the lamb. You carry my healing in your hands. Jesus, there is no one like you, Jesus. There is no one like you.
Lord Jesus, there is no one like you. You are unique and all-powerful, the Creator and the Savior. You are the Lion of Judah, and you're also the Passover Lamb. Shed your blood for us. We praise you and worship you today. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Today's scripture reading is from Genesis chapter 7, verses 1 through 10. Then the Lord said to Noah, "Go into the ark, you and all your household, for I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. Take with you 7 pairs of all clean animals, the male and his mate, and a pair of the animals that are not clean, the male and his mate, and 7 pairs of the birds of the heaven, also male and female, to keep their offspring alive on the face of all earth. For in 7 days I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and everything that I have made I will blot out from the face of the ground." And Noah did all that the Lord had commanded him. Noah was 600 years old when the flood of waters came upon the earth. And Noah and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him went into the ark to escape the waters of the flood. Of clean animals and of animals that are not clean, and of birds and of everything that creeps on the ground, 2 and 2, male and female, went into the ark with Noah as God had commanded Noah. And after 7 days, the waters of the flood came upon the earth. May the Lord bless his reading.
Thank you, Craig. There's a bulletin insert for taking notes, if you like. And I'd just like to start by asking if you think that the world's gone crazy sometimes. There's crazies in Washington. There's crazies in California. And there's crazies everywhere, it seems like, right? Except for us, of course. And maybe you've been criticized for your faith. Maybe you've told people that you believe the Bible is true. You believe the stories of creation and Noah and Jonah. Or you said, "I'm pro-life," and you've been criticized and you've been attacked for believing that Jesus is God and the Bible is true. Or maybe you've just feel like the water's coming up to your neck and you're waiting for God. And you just wonder, when am I going to get an answer from the Lord? Well, I think if we look at the principles in Noah's life, we can really get some help to how to stand up to opposition of the world and how to stand up to ridicule, and also what to do when it seems like the waters keep rising and we don't have an answer from the Lord. So I want to first look into some interesting facts about Noah and the ark. You noticed in the reading it said Noah and his wife and his 3 sons and their wives. So 8 people went into the ark. Now this kanji character that's used in China and Japan, you see this 3 radicals here. This radical can be a vessel or a boat. This is 8, and this is mouth or people. So around 4,000 years ago, this character was created for boat with 8 people as part of the boat. And there are other Bible lessons in the Chinese characters. There's actually a guy wrote a book about them. This is just one of them, but that's point one about one reason that I feel that this story is true. When you think about, is the story of Noah true? When I was a kid and I first heard the story, I just thought it was a fun story. as I grew older and studied science and studied engineering, I was very skeptical of whether it was true. And when I became a believer, then I had to do a lot of research to convince myself that it was true. And I sincerely believe it's a true story that really happened. Now, one reason, Noah's mentioned in 9 different books of the Bible. Besides Genesis, he's in 1 Chronicles, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Matthew, Luke, Hebrew, and 1 and 2 Peter. And Noah's not just any run-of-the-mill character. He's also only one of 2 people besides Jesus who said they found favor with God. That was Moses and Noah were both said to have found favor with God. And then Jesus talks about Noah and the flood in Matthew 24, verses 37 to 38. Or Jesus is speaking, and he says, "Or as were the days of Noah, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day when Noah entered the ark. And they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away. And so will be the coming of the Son of Man." So Jesus compared his second coming to the way it was at the time of Noah. And then probably this is the image that you usually see when you think of Noah. There's always a couple of giraffes, right? It's like the ark was not big enough for the giraffes, and they're always having their heads sticking out the top or out a window. And you have all these animals, and everybody looks happy. In fact, I thought about including in the praise time the kids' song about Noah, Arky Arky. Anybody know that song? But Jan kind of nixed that, you know. The Lord told Noah there's going to be a floody, floody. Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. Jan nixed it, so. It's more than a kid's story. And really, the ark, I don't think the ark was like that. When you look at the description of the ark, it was about 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, and 45 feet high, and it had 3 decks and then a roof. So it was all closed in except for a few small windows, and it was covered with pitch inside and out. The largest cruise ships now are about 1,000 feet, so it's about half the size of the largest cruise ships. But it was really built for going through big waves and storms, which must have been taking place. I mean, there must have been huge waves taking place. So there's 2 theories. The Bible scholars have 2 different theories about the flood. One is the universal flood, that the entire earth was flooded, that the mountains were lower. You know, that you can find fossils way up into the tops of the Himalayas, and all the high mountains have fossils on them. So they were down under the sea level at some point in time. And God could have raised the mountains and created the continents at this time, the universal flood theory. And then there's also the regional flood theory, that the Bible talks about the world at that time was flooded, and that's mentioned in 1 and 2 Peter. So that theory is that mankind really didn't spread out. You know, if you read the Tower of Babel, mankind, even after the flood, was just staying in that one area, present-day Middle East, North Africa. So the regional flood theory is that the flood covered all of where mankind was in the Middle East and North Africa area, and those were the animals from those areas that were taken onto the ark. And so I think, you know, either one is squares with the Bible, so you don't have to feel like you either have to believe science or you have to believe the Bible. I was trained as a scientist in college, and I believe both science and the Bible are true. And some science just has to catch up in some areas to what the Bible's been telling us. But the Bible is not written as a scientific book either. It gives us the facts to teach us about salvation, and it doesn't try to give us a scientific description of everything that took place. So with that, what can we learn about salvation and about going through the storms of life? What principles can we pick up from the time of Noah? As I said, I think that the ark was probably in storms for a long time. It says that the waters didn't recede until after 150 days, so it was almost a half a year, 5 months, that the waters were rising and storms. And if there were any kind of continental movements, I mean, there would have been huge tidal waves. And I think probably that God just caused them to all go into hibernation in this ark for that time. And then it took 7 months for the waters to recede to where God told them to go out of the ark. So they were in the ark for a year and 10 days, it says in the Bible. So as Derek and I have been talking about the scarlet thread of redemption through the Old Testament, the stories in the Old Testament that point to redemption that we have in Jesus. And so I want to look at the way of salvation for Noah and the way of salvation for us. First, for Noah, God instructs Noah in the way of salvation. He says there's going to be a flood, and this is how you need to escape from that flood. And you have to do it God's way. This is the only way that you're going to be saved, is to build this ark. Now, Noah had never seen a flood. We don't know if he'd seen rain. We don't know how close he was to a body of water. But he's building this ark probably miles away from any body of water. And he just has to trust God that there's going to be this huge amount of water in the future. And he's probably never seen a ship this big. But in order to be saved, he has to believe the promise, and he has to follow through and actually build it. So he couldn't just say, well, yeah, I believe God that there's going to be a flood, and then go ahead and continue with his farming. He had to take action and actually build the ark to be saved. And so the principle is that God provides the way for Noah and his family to be saved. And then after they built the ark, it says that God shut up the door into the ark. So God provides the door to salvation, and God protects them during the time of the flood. And he protects them while the earth is being judged. And that's the same that's going to happen in the future with salvation for us. Jesus is our ark. We have to enter into relationship with Jesus. He instructs us about salvation. He says, I'm going to provide the way of salvation. You can't earn your way into salvation. You have to trust in the Lord Jesus. And we have to believe his promises, and we have to believe that he really lived and died for us on the cross, and he was raised from the dead. We don't have proof. We can't look at old newsreels and see proof that Jesus died on the cross and proof that he rose from the dead. We, like Noah, we have to believe what God has told us. We have to believe that if we believe that we'll be forgiven and that we'll have eternal life. We can't prove that either. Only Jesus has been in both places, living on earth and been in heaven, and he's the witness. But again, we can't just believe intellectually and say, well, yeah, I believe that, and then just continue on like our lives were before. As we studied James last year, proof of our belief is actually living the way Jesus calls us to live and do good works to help the poor and the sick and those in prison. Those are evidences that our belief is real. Believing what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount and forgiving our brothers and sisters and praying for our enemies and living out what God told us to do through Jesus's commands and promises. And so it's the same as what Noah experienced. So Noah is a type and a symbol of the salvation now that we have in Jesus. And then God made a covenant with Noah, and God also made a covenant with us. God's covenant with Noah, first of all, he says in Genesis 8, 21, 22, he says, "I'll never again curse the ground because of man, for the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Never will I ever again strike down every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease." And so it doesn't mean that God removed the curse of the ground during time of Adam and Eve, because we still have weeds and we still have thistles, but he's saying he's not going to curse the ground even more, or he's not going to cause another flood to kill everything. And so that's part of his covenant, to not curse the ground, not cause another flood. Then he also increases the freedoms of the of people, and he says that you can not only eat vegetables, but you can eat of all living things, everything that moves on the earth. So he actually opened up the door for them to not only be vegetarians, but they could eat meat from that time on. And he gave proof, the rainbow, as a sign of his covenant that he would not cause the flood to destroy the earth again. And then he gave commands to Noah. He said, he repeated the command from Genesis 1 to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And then again, the promise that everything living should be food for you, the green plants and everything I give you. But there was one stipulation, not to eat flesh with its blood still in it, because the life is in the blood, so the blood should be drained from any animal that's eaten. And then also, he said, those who shed blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. Because God made man in his own image. Prior to the time of Noah, there was no commandments about murder, what to do about murder. And the earth apparently was filled with murder at the time of Noah. And people were just killing other people at will. And so God says if someone kills someone, murders someone, that their life should be taken as well. Because when you kill a human being, you're desecrating God's image. That's the image of God in each person, and you're desecrating that to show how serious of a crime it is. Now, God's covenant with us starts with Romans 10:9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And so there's that promise. There's what we have to believe, and then the promise that we'll be saved. And then God also gives us commands and promises. He says, be witness to all the nations. That's from Acts 1:8. And make disciples of all nations. That's from Matthew 28. He commanded us to love one another as Jesus loved us. And then he promised to always be with us. He promised us the Holy Spirit. And these are all things we have talked about before, but I just want you to kind of see how there's a parallel between Noah and how God has promised us and also commanded us to get the gospel out to all mankind. And I want to finish with practical applications for us when we're living in a world like Noah. Noah pretty much stood alone. The whole world was going crazy, and Noah alone was found to be righteous. And you can imagine, it's not written, there's nothing written in the Bible about what people were saying to Noah or doing to Noah. But you have to believe that there was a lot of criticism or mocking going on if you're building this giant boat nowhere near water, and especially when you start gathering animals and taking them into the boat. And then there's no water yet. It says that they all went into the ark and waited 7 days. Can you imagine waiting 7 days? I can just imagine crowds. You know, if it were present day now, you'd have CNN and Fox and all the news guys out there say, "Hey, Noah, where's your big flood?" You know, and there would be intense ridicule. And if you go out on the street and say, you know, the Lord's coming back, you're going to get ridiculed. So, standing against the world like Noah did. Now, first of all, it says that Noah was righteous. And what does that, mean that he was just always doing the right thing? That's part of it. But the main reason he's called righteous is because he believed what God said, even though it was just totally beyond his experience. And he had to just take it by faith that what God said was going to happen would happen, and if he built this ark, his family would be saved. And so he just believed beyond rationality and comprehension that what God said was true. And so in Hebrews 11, he's part of the what we call the hall of faith, the hall of fame of faithful people, which says, "By faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith." So it was Noah's faith that what God was telling him was true, and that this was the only way he could be saved, that that's why he was called righteous. And then he was a man of strong, not just ordinary faith, he was a man of strong faith, because he is included in this, what I would call the great faith people of the Old Testament. In Ezekiel, when Ezekiel's prophesying about how God is so disappointed in Israel at this time in around 700 BC, that the Babylonians are going to come and they're going to destroy Jerusalem. And Ezekiel is warning the people, and he says to them, "The word came to me, son of man, when a land sins against me by acting faithlessly, and I stretch out my hand against it and break its supply of bread and send famine upon it and cut off from it man and beast, even if these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they would deliver but their own lives, but their right by their righteousness, declares the Lord God." So he's saying, you know, I'm going to allow the Babylonians to destroy Judah and northern Israel and Jerusalem. And even if Noah and Daniel and Job were standing there, it would still be destroyed, and only those three would be left. Now, being in the company of Daniel and Job, to me, is being really put up there on a high pedestal. Job, you know, suffered the loss of his entire family except for his wife and all of his property. And then he was struck with boils and pain. And then his friends came and to comfort him and told him, "Well, it's because you're a sinner that you're suffering all this." I mean, Job suffered immense pain and loss. And yet he did not deny God. He did not curse God. He did not quit believing in God. So he was a man of great faith. And then Daniel also was a strong believer in God, faithful believer, and he was carried off as a teenager, carried off to Babylon, and he had to serve these evil kings in Babylon for the rest of his life. There's no record that he was able to return because he would have been, 85, 90 years old at the end of the 70-year exile. And he too was faithful to the Lord, and even when he was told to worship the image that was created and to quit praying to his God or else he'd be thrown in the lion's den, he said, well, I'm still going to pray to my God. And he was thrown in the lion's den. So these were great, great men of faith, and Noah is counted with them. And so the point being that no matter how grim things look for us, we have to be strong in faith. That we can't see the future. We can't see exactly what's going to happen. But like Noah and Job and Daniel, we just got to trust God that he's going to get us through this and be strong in faith. Because our God is powerful, as we sang, and there's nothing impossible for our Lord, and we have to trust in that. And then, so we trust God to bring us through the waters. And when Noah built the ark, and there's no record that he knew how long it was going to be, how long he would be floating around with these animals in this ark. And so he just had to trust God when he was going through this time of high waters, that God was going to bring him through that situation. And we have to believe that God is with us, even when it seems like we've been abandoned. There's Psalms, even David cried out at times in the Psalms, God, why have you forsaken me? Where are you? But we don't know what Noah prayed during this time, but he might have had times where he just wondered, how long is this going to go? Are we ever going to get out of this ark? And the point being to me is that we just have to believe that God's going to get us through it. He's not going to abandon us. And to not give up, believe that God will bring us through. It says that Noah may have spent 120 years building the ark. We don't know how long exactly that he built the ark, but it says in Genesis 5 or 6 that God decided he was only going to give 120 years to mankind. And some say that it means he's going to shorten man's lifespan, but it's more likely that it was going to be 120 years and then the flood was going to come. But in any event, it says in the Bible that Noah preached to people while he was building the ark. And he didn't give up, and he just kept working and building that ark and preaching the gospel. And we don't know, whatever God's given us to do, we don't know how long it's going to take to accomplish what God wants us to do. But he doesn't want us to give up, just like he didn't want Noah to give up. And when we're ridiculed, we're not to ridicule back. Peter said in 1 Peter about Jesus, he says, Jesus committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. And so I think we can assume that Noah did not spend his time arguing with people. I'm sure he preached to them and he warned them to repent. But there's no record of anybody else saying, hey, maybe we should build an ark too. But he he just continued working, and he did not argue back or criticize. He just warned the people, and that's what we're called to do. We're not to get out in the street and just get into arguments with people, but we are supposed to tell people, you know, I believe in a God that's going to come back someday, and someday we're all going to have to stand before him. And that's all I want you to know, that God loves you and God wants you to be prepared for when you meet him. And then don't be discouraged when it seems like your obedience is foolishness. As I said, Noah and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives went into the ark to escape the waters of the flood. And after 7 days, the waters of the flood came upon the earth. So I just imagine that had to be a long 7 days, and maybe the longest 7 days in his life, waiting to see, well, are we just going to be the biggest fools in the world, or is God really going to do what he said he's going to do? I can think of stories that I've met families who are going to be missionaries in, they're going to go to Muslim countries, and they have children. And one family in particular is going to go to the Philippines, and they're going to work in some of the more dangerous part of the Philippines, where there's Muslim terrorists in operation. And people would tell them they're crazy, you know, taking children to a place where there's Muslim terrorists to do missionary work, you know. People are going to tell you you're crazy when you go into missions, even if you're going to Japan. People will tell you you're crazy. And it's a fool, you're foolish to take your children to this country or that country. But even when it seems like foolishness in the world's eyes, we can't be discouraged. Just as Noah was not discouraged, he just kept plugging along building that ark. And then don't panic when the high waters don't seem to go away. We don't know if Noah knew how long it would last, but there's no indication that he knew that it would be 150 days of high water before it started to go down. And we just don't know when our stressful experience might end. It might end tomorrow. It may go for a year. We don't know. But we have to just keep waiting patiently for the Lord. I thought about when we came back from Japan, our support was pretty good while we were in Japan. But as we came back, people were, oh, well, you're not in Japan anymore. Well, we're going to support some other people. And our support kept going down. And it actually cost more to live in California than it did in Japan. So things were not going the right direction. Cost of living going up and support going down. And I was getting pretty frustrated and not very patient at times. And I thought maybe I should just quit ministry and go back to engineering. And then I thought, well, I don't really want to have to move to LA. So maybe I'll just start a window washing business or a dog walking business or something. I was looking around for all different kind of things to do just to keep our heads above water. And this went on for 2-3 years. We were just barely getting by, but God finally brought the waters down and our income started to get up with our expenses. And God took care of us, and he continues to take care of us. But sometimes the storms last longer than we would like, and we just don't know how long it's going to last. But God always brings us through the storm. He always brings us through. So if you're going through a storm now, or if you're being criticized by friends, neighbors, family, I hope you remember the principles of Noah's life. Noah believed God even when it seemed that it was beyond his comprehension, beyond his experience, but he believed God, And he didn't know how long it was going to last, but he believed that there would be an end to it. He had faith to follow, even when it was unpopular, even when he was probably ridiculed and mocked. He had faith enough to preach to the people. He not only believed and did the work of the Lord, but he spoke his faith out to the people. And he just continued working. And there's no record that he got into arguments or tried to, start a campaign or made big posters or anything criticizing the world. He just continued on and just shared, you need to be prepared. Maybe you ought to build your own ark. And he continued to share, just like he's asking us to share the gospel, love people, be witness, do the work of the Lord, and don't let the crazies in the world and the critics in the world keep you down, and don't let them get you into get you sidetracked into arguing with them. Just keep on. Or as Jan reminded me of one of our professors in seminary, always said, just keep the main thing the main thing. The main thing is the gospel to the world. And don't get sidetracked by the critics and the skeptics that are around us. Because God is with us, and actually it's quite an adventure, as Noah probably wrote afterwards, that it was quite an adventure that he went through. And walking with God is an adventure. There's definitely floods and times of worry and times of stress and being ridiculed, but it's an adventure, and I highly recommend taking that adventure. So let's pray. Lord, thank you for the lessons from Noah. Thank you for the example of faith that he was. And thank you for the lesson to us that this world is not going to continue the way it is forever. You will come back, and it will be like the days of Noah. People are going to be caught off guard. Some people are not going to be ready. Lord, we pray that you would get your gospel out to every nation and people, tribe and tongue before that time, that you would use Bethany Church and other churches of Santa Barbara to reach the people here in our city, in our county, our country, and around the world before you come back. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, if the praise team can come up and join me, we will... Grace greater than our sin.
The mighty cross, grace.
is the slave that we cannot hide. What can avail to wash it away? Look, there is flowing a crimson tide, whiter than snow you laid here today. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see his face, will you this day with his grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sins.
And final reminder of where to look when things are looking grim in the world. Our doxology, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Final benediction from 1 Peter. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Blessings upon you. Please join us in Fellowship Hall for fellowship, and also tone chimes practice will start at noon today.